What would you do if Creality asked you to try their laser engraver? Of course I said yes. Hey, if you spend some time in the garage looking for excuses to be there, like I do, this has to be an excellent one. Over the years and for several times, I found myself wanting to engrave metal stuff. So when Creality offered me a chance to try it, I couldn't say no. I know what you're thinking, a 4-stroke laser can't engrave steel. So this is the Falcon 2, 22 watt version. There's the 40 watt version, but I'm a lousy YouTuber so I only got the 22 watt. And this machine is awesome, not only because it can make coasters to sell on Etsy, but also because it allows someone like me, who doesn't know a thing about lasers, start engraving stuff in 10 minutes. With this machine you don't have to worry about assembly, it comes in one piece out of the box. You do need to screw in the feet and fit the laser module, but that's nothing. If you can change tools on your lathe, you can do this. Next, what you need to know before turning on the machine is that there are safety measures that must be taken when using a blue diode laser. These lasers operate in the 455 nanometer wavelength range, which is visible to humans and animals. This means they can get you blind in a fraction of a second, if they fire directly into your eyes or if you are exposed to a reflection. This is very important, and if there's one thing you should take away from this video, let it be this. Oh, by the way, do not connect your air assist pump to anything else other than the laser head. I feel like I should mention that. When you turn the machine on, the laser will not fire. It will only fire when you tell it to do so. You can do that by feeding some G-code in a microSD card or directly through your computer, connected with a USB-C cable. I prefer the second option because it's quicker and provides us with better tools to align the laser head with the workpiece. Those tools are actually software. You can either use Laser GRBL, which is free, or you can use Lightburn. Lightburn is paid, but it's a permanent license. After the first year, you won't get updates anymore, but you can use that version forever. I've chosen to go with Lightburn. If everybody ends up using it, I trust that's the way to go. The first time you launch Lightburn, you need to import a configuration file that's available in the pen drive included in the laser. Next, you need to select the communication port between the computer and the laser. And that's it, you're set to go. But before you do anything, you need to know about the list. Yes, there is a list. It contains materials that are not safe to cut or engrave. Just look it up online, and don't go crazy engraving your name on everything, including your new bathroom's PVC pipes. If this is your first project, I recommend starting with wood, simply because it's cheap and readily available. Birch plywood seems to be a popular choice, but one I can seem to find around here. Instead, I'll be using standard plywood. Just as you need to know the type of material you're machining to dial in your speeds and feeds, you need to do the same with the laser. Speed is rated in millimeters per second, and the feed, which is actually not feed but power, is a percentage of the laser's power. Lightburn has a cool feature that allows you to create a chart for this, so you can test your material and determine what works and what doesn't. As a starting point for this test, Creality provides a table, with good ballpark figures for the most common materials used. So given that I want to cut plywood, I'm interested in performing test cuts from 10 to 100% power, with a laser moving from 400 to 1300 mm per second. If everything goes well, we should have some successful cuts. Framing the job will give you an indication of where the laser is going to work. You must ensure the material is correctly positioned within that frame. The last adjustment needed is focusing the laser. Using this tool provided with the laser, you need to move the head up or down according to what you're doing, engraving or cutting. Now, clicking the start button will fire the laser, so you know what I'm going to say. Everyone around you should leave the room, including animals. As for you, you don't need to stare at the laser throughout the entire job. And whenever you do, make sure you're wearing safety glasses. Not the green ones, those were last year's fashion. Grab some orange ones that cover the wavelength of the laser, and make sure they're certified. Remember what the other guy said, you only have two pairs of eyes. What we can see here in this test is that the laser power needs to be at 80% to start cutting, and that's with the slowest speed tested. We can make it a little bit faster, but then we need to increase the power to at least 90%. I've done another test just for engraving, and this is what I got. I'd say 50% power is where this laser shows a good engraving for this type of wood. And I'm liking 8000 mm per second. To change from cutting to engraving, you just need to go to Edit Material Setting and change from Line to Fill. One thing though, and I don't see many people mentioning this, is that working with wood stinks. Basically, you're burning through the wood and it generates a lot of fumes. If you're thinking of doing this in your living room, you might want to rethink that. Just so you have an idea, I had the garage doors open and the entire place stinked for a few days. My recommendation for wood is doing it outdoors. Of course, you can always buy an enclosure and it will definitely help with venting the fumes outside. This one is made by Creality, specifically for this laser. I'm not using it just because I need to get the shots for the video, but I've used it before and I can tell you it does help. And it's another layer of protection for your eyes too. So if you own or if you're thinking of owning a laser, an enclosure might be an interesting accessory. I don't know if you've seen my last video, but I made these, and I think it would be cool to make a box for them. There are a few box generators online, Maker Case is one of them and I'm going to use it. It's probably the easiest one to use. I just need to enter the parameters here on the left, and then click the download button. That will give me the file I need for Lightburn. Then I just add some text I want to engrave, and then I tell the software that this color is to be cut with these settings. And this is to be engraved. Notice that I'm turning off the air assist for engraving. This machine comes with an air pump, so the laser head can blow some air to clear the smoke from the laser and blow away dust particles. That's what this air assist is. From what I've seen, it should be mostly used when cutting. It helps to get cleaner cuts. For engraving, we can turn it off. And if for any reason we forget to turn it off in the software, the laser has this knob right here. This allows you to control the pump manually. Pretty cool, huh? And it wasn't too much work. Last year, when I rebuilt the lathe, I was thinking of improving the way wipers, and I made this. This is kind of an abandoned project, but I thought to bring it back today because now with the laser, I might be able to cut better rubber inserts than these. If you make a search online, you'll find a lot of people telling a diode laser can cut silicone rubber, because it can resist to the heat. Well, I have these, and my phone says it's silicone rubber. If it is, it should be safe to cut, and I think it should leave a trace of white dust after the cut. Let's try it! This was 3 passes at 100% power. Cut all the way through, but it's kinda rough. Let's change to 2 passes and see what happens. It didn't go all the way through, but the shape looks better, it's sharper. And I can probably finish it with a blade. Yep, I like this one better. I think the internet is half right on this one. Next, let's try some metal. Creality says this laser can engrave stainless steel, and that seems to be what most people choose to show. So, since there are many examples of that already, I'm not going to bother. Lately I've been mostly using 4140, so let's begin with that. I'm going to make the material test grid, just like I did before, only this time I have to split it in two grids. From what I can see, there's not enough power below 60% to make a decent mark. But above that, it actually looks quite good. In fact, this goes to show you can mark steel if your diode laser is powerful enough. And if it's not, I have something to show you. Brilliance makes several types of etching sprays that help the engraving and marking of materials. This one is specific for metals, so let's make another test grid. There's not much of a difference in these samples, so let's try below 60% to see if we get a different result. So this is what this spray does. It enhances the marking no matter the power. Even the 10% test looks decent. This has to be a huge enabler for people with weak lasers. And if you think another type of coating, like an etch primer, will do the same job, it won't. And it smells bad. With the Brilliance spray, you don't get any kind of smell. Believe it or not, this is the result of an engraving test grid on aluminum. Not even a tiny mark to be seen. Luckily, Brilliance got me covered again, and sent over a sample of another one of their sprays, this one made for aluminum. And you know what? It works! An interesting use case for engraved aluminum is machine dials. I want to make one real fast, so I begin with a quick sketch on Fusion 360. Then I right-click the sketch, in sketch mode, and export in DXF. Now I can open that file in Lightburn. It might need some cleanup, but it's not too bad. Since the dial is made from round stock, this is the perfect time to make use of the rotary kit that Creality sent me. Have in mind this is the Pro version, with a baby chuck and tailstock. There's another version with rollers, but it's not the same thing. If you buy one of these, make sure that you go to device settings in Lightburn and disable the auto home when you turn the machine on and finish a job. Now if my math is fine, this should make a perfect dial. Incredible! I like it a lot. While we're here, I guess it wouldn't hurt to try brass. The result with the spray is also very good. Never mind the graduations, I use the same file as before and this piece of stock is smaller. Next, I'm trying without the spray. And the result? The unmachined part has very light marks. I guess those should fade away fairly quick. But there are no marks at all in the machined surface. Now that's interesting. Oh, and Delrin? It's a piece of cake. Alright. I guess I had to try stainless. I didn't use any spray or anything, and I don't know which flavor of stainless this is. I could get some colors, which is that big deal about engraving stainless, but I couldn't get those bright reds and blues. Probably the fact that this is polished stainless doesn't help. But this metal engraving experience has been very cool. I guess I've been bending the rules a little bit, because a diode laser is not supposed to engrave metals. On the other hand, a fiber laser costs 3 to 4 times the price, so an infrared laser can engrave metals and would be in the same price range as a diode laser, but they can't work with wood or glass. All in all, I'm finding this diode laser a good all-around tool to have in the shop. But before we wrap this up for today, and after all this engraving, it's best to check if the lens got dirty. In case it gets too bad, the amber LED on the laser head starts flashing. But let's not wait for that. Okay, this is it for today. This was a different video than usual, but I tried my best to keep it interesting for you guys. If you think this is a little bit biased, yeah, it might be. But I've never used another laser, and you've seen what this can do. If by any chance you're looking to buy one, check the links in the description. Have in mind that the rotary kit, the enclosure and the large honeycomb are sold separately from the machine. Well, that's it. Stay safe, guys.